set my house in order 42 years ago last August, just coming as a poor sinner and put my trust in the Savior when I left the indictment. It's that simple. Salvation is so simple that people stumble over the simplicity of it. It's just faith is nothing more than believing what Christ has done for you and believing what God has promised you when you do believe Him. I'm going to read it in the Gospel of Mark chapter 8. Somebody has well said that everybody begins their life crying. Every child begins life crying. Now they say that's a healthy baby. Now there's something wrong with somebody when they cry. They're hurting. Somebody has said that everybody starts their life crying. They go through life sighing and they end life dying. I think Job put it well in Job 14 and verse 1. Man that is born of a woman is fewer days before it comes. Life doesn't offer very much. When you're young, it looks so bright. But when you get old and look back over it, you can say, like Solomon of old, it's all vanity and vexation of spirit. That is apart from Christ, apart from knowing Christ, because He puts purpose in your life. Mark chapter 8 and verse 1, we read this. In those days the multitude, being very great and having nothing to eat, Jesus called His disciples unto Him and saith unto them, I have compassion on the multitude, because they have now been with me 3 days and have nothing to eat. Then I sent them away fasting to their own houses. They will faint by the way, for divers of them came from far. And His disciples answered Him, from whence can a man satisfy these men with bread here in the wilderness? And He asked them, how many loaves have you, ye? And they said, 7. And He commanded the people to sit down on the ground. And He took the 7 loaves and gave thanks and bread, and gave to His disciples to set before them. And they did set them before the people. And they had a few small fishes, and He blessed and commanded to set them also before them. So they did eat and were filled. From whence can a man satisfy these men with bread in the wilderness? The Lord Jesus said in John chapter 5, verse 35, 6 rather, verse 35, He said, I am the bread of life. He that cometh to me shall never hunger, and he that believeth on me shall never thirst. Now they were all at a feast. The whole chapter, John 6, is about bread, about feast of one sort or another. And He's using the common everyday language. And He's saying, I'm another kind of a bread. That bread you're eating can fill your stomachs. But I'm the type of bread that can give you life, can give you satisfaction, can fulfill your soul. And if you eat of me, you'll never thirst. And you'll never hunger again. You know, the pursuit of man is satisfaction. Everybody's looking for something to satisfy. Proverbs chapter 27 and verse 20 says that hell and destruction are never over, and the eyes of man are never satisfied. John D. Rockefeller was a young man in America, and he worked hard, and at 33 years old he was the first millionaire, known millionaire in America. At 43 years old, John D. Rockefeller, the old original, at 43 years old, he was the first known billionaire in America, and and property of the world. Somebody said, Mr. Rockefeller, how much more are you going to make before you retire? And he said, just a little bit more. Just a little bit more. At 53 years old, John D. Rockefeller was living on crackers, cream of wheat, milk, and doctors had given him up. They had pretty well written his obituary. They said he was going to die. John D. Rockefeller lived to be 93 years old. Somebody told him that the Bible said it's more blessed to give than it is to receive. And he started giving away much of his wealth. And instead of trying to find something to satisfy his greed and to fulfill his self, he started giving away. And of course, it reversed his health. And he went on to live an old man. The Bible says all the labor of a man is for his belly, and yet the appetite is never filled. And if you're here tonight and you're not saved, and you're honest with yourself and honest with God, there's something in your life missing, lacking. You are not satisfied with your life. There's a vacuum, there's an emptiness, there's a loneliness, there's a hunger, you don't know what it is, you don't know what will fill it, you've tried whatever you can get your hands on, it still doesn't satisfy, and that's exactly what the Bible says. And all the labor of man is for that day, as well, and yet the appetite is never satisfied. In order for a person to be satisfied, they have to be saved. And they have to be sure of it. And then they'll be satisfied. I remember as a boy, 12, 13 years old, this terrible unrest, this looking for something to satisfy. And I started out in life at 14, started out to work, started out in the world, thought if I could get away from my parents and be my own boss, I'd be satisfied. But I got away from my parents and I became my own boss and I wasn't satisfied. Whatever the others were going after, it looked like they were being satisfied, I went after the same thing. But it just didn't satisfy that vacuum and that emptiness in my life. I thought maybe if I get married, get a fine girl and settle down and get married, I'll be satisfied. Well, I found a girl and we've been married for 50 years this past April. And we've been very happy together. But that did not satisfy my inner being. It was only a few years after I was married that I come to put my trust in Christ, who is the bread of life. And I know what that verse means by experience. When Jesus said, I am the bread of life, he that cometh to me shall never hunger, and he that believeth on me shall never thirst, and he that believeth on me shall never hunger. I got that little backwards, but that's the message of the verse. To be saved and to be sure of it is to be satisfied. You see, why man is so full of unrest? He's a sinner. And deep down inside him, he knows it. He doesn't want to be told that. A man will defend himself every time. When Adam sinned, the first thing he did, he blamed it on Eve. And when God confronted Eve, she blamed it on the serpent. The devil. The devil's been blaming God for it ever since. But deep down inside of you, you know you're a sinner. That makes you restless. Because sin brings guilt. And guilt brings fear. That makes you dissatisfied. Makes you restless. In order for you to be satisfied, that sin has got to be removed so that you will no longer have that guilt and you will no longer have that fear, and you can do absolutely nothing to remove that sin. You're born a sinner. You've practiced sin ever since, in one form or another. You may not be as bad as your neighbor, but you're still a sinner in the sight of God. That's why you're not satisfied. That's why you need to be saved. So, how? My brother was reading in the book of Jonah. Jonah said in Jonah chapter 2, verse 7, he says, salvation is all the Lord. Now that little preposition all means that's where it comes from. That's the source of it. He is the source of salvation. He's the Savior, that's why. So it comes from the Lord. Jonah cried out of the belly of hell, he said. And he said in this sense, if I ever get out of here, the Lord's going to get me out of here. And that he was absolutely helpless to get out of that fishing belt. And he knew that if he ever got out of there, it would take a miracle, and only God could save him out of that fishing belly. Only God could save him out of the belly of hell, and only God could save you out of the belly of hell. Salvation is all of the Lord. That's the source of it. He planned it. And he provided it when he sent the Savior into the world to take your sin and my sin upon himself and bear it in his own body on the cross. He provided it. So it's all of the Lord. There was a missionary doctor one time, a colored man. His name was Davis. And he often came, he was an Indian. He labored in India. He often came to England on a little vacation once in a while. And he was riding on a train one day, and there was a couple of dignified ladies there, and they looked at him and saw he was an Indian. And they thought probably a Hindu, somebody that had never heard about God. So we better tell him a little bit about God. So they started to talk to him about the Lord, about God. And he said to them, he said, what do you have to do in your religion to get up to a better life? Oh, I said, you've got, there's a command, there's 10 commandments, you've got to keep those commandments, and you've got to go to church, and you've got to be baptized, and you've got to live a good life, and do all the best you can, and you'll get in. Eventually, you'll get in. And he said, well, there's only a two little letters different with your religion and mine. And they said, what do you mean? He said, the two little letters N-E. They didn't spell anything. They were confused. He said, your religion is D-O all you can. Mine is D-O-N-E. And he went on to tell them that salvation was a finished work at the cross of Calvary, and it was a free gift to anybody that would receive it. See, you couldn't do anything to put away your sin. Have you lived from now until the day you died and you'd never committed another sin in your life? You'd still die and go to hell, because God requires that which is past. Those sins are all charged against you. And a holy, righteous God that never does anything wrong is not going to let you out of those sins. You're going to have to be called to account. It only took one sin to drive Adam out of the presence of God and make him lost to God. One sin will keep you out of heaven. And God has provided, planned, and provided a Savior that's able to take that sin away so that it just never came to exist. It just blotted it out of existence. So powerful is the blood of Christ and the sacrifice of Christ to take away sin. Saved, salvation is of the Lord. Now salvation isn't only of the Lord, but but salvation is by the Lord. After the Lord finished his work on earth, of laying down his life on the cross of Calvary, when he cried, "It is finished, completed," and he dismissed his own spirit and died, he buried it, he rose, he went back to heaven, and he sent the Holy Spirit into the world and inspired men to write this book in order that he might produce that salvation in you. And it's the Spirit of God that convicts you, that brings light and understanding to you. It's through the Word of God. The Spirit of God works. And salvation is not only of the Lord, but salvation is by the Lord. Deuteronomy 33, verse 29 says about the happy people that are saved by the Lord. Saved. How the Lord saves us. Our part is very simple. We must repent of our sins. That means we must have a change of mind and, of course, a change of purpose against sin, against God. God doesn't save anybody in their sins. He saves you from your sins. But repentance isn't turning over a new leaf. It's not reforming your life. It's not giving up your bad habits. It's just saying, listen, I acknowledge what I am in the sight of God. I'm a sinner, and I sin against God, and I'm a rebel, and I don't deserve to be saved, but I don't want to do that anymore. I have a change of purpose, but I'm helpless to do anything more than that. That's all you're able to do about it, because you can't take away what you see. But you can turn in your heart from your sin. And when you turn from your sin, you have to turn to the Savior. He's the only one that's made a satisfaction for your sins. He's the only one that died for your sins. He's the only one that judged for your sins. So salvation is of the Lord, and salvation is by the Lord. And it only takes place when you repent and you trust the Savior with all your heart. This matter of trusting Christ is so simple, but it must be done with all your heart. All your trust must be in Christ in order to be saved. You say, well, that sounds good, and how can I be sure of it? We can be sure of it by the Word of God. Salvation rests on two foundations. Number one, the finished work of Christ on the cross of Calvary. The other one is the Word of God, the promises of God. The Bible says the law of the Word of the Lord is perfect, converting the soul. And when Jesus cried on the cross and it's finished, he could have used the same word, perfect, completed, finished. Back in the book of Exodus, when God redeemed the people out of Egypt, he told them to take a little lamb and to kill that little lamb. And he said, now the last plague of Egypt is going to happen at midnight. The death angel is going to come down, and every firstborn child in the land of Egypt in every house is going to die. Then Pharaoh, that wicked king, will let the people go. But he said to the Israelites, I want you to take a lamb. I want you to kill that lamb. I want you to take and catch the blood of that lamb of the basin. And I want you to take that blood outdoors. And I want you to put it on the door casings, as we would say, over the top of the door and on the sides of the door. And God said, you do that, and when I see the blood, the death angel, I'll tell him to go right by. He won't stop there. I can imagine they, after they applied that blood, the likelihood is they went inside. They said, listen, we've applied the blood. And we've got the promise of God that when he saw that blood, he would pass right by. We're not a bit worried about the death angel coming in here. If they really believe God, see the salvation, their salvation from death, there was in the blood. But how could they be sure of it? God had said, when I see the blood, I will pass over you. Has not God said, he that believeth on the Son, have everlasting life? John 3, verse 36. God says if you trust in his Son, if you depend on his Son, if you rely on his Son and what he's done for you, God says you have everlasting life. That's what the Bible is written for. 1 John chapter 5 and verse 13 says, "These things have I written unto you that do believe on the name of the Son of God." What for? "That ye might know that ye have eternal life." That's the kind of life you're going to have moving to heaven forever. Saved by the blood, sure of it by the word. Many people make a mistake there. They say they trust the Lord as their Savior, but if they don't feel saved, they don't know whether they're saved or not. Listen, your salvation doesn't depend on your feelings. Oftentimes you feel sick and you go to the doctor and he says it's all in your head. Other times you feel well and you go to the doctor and he tells you you're sick. Your feelings can deceive you. A lot of times deceives you. But listen, the word of God will never deceive you. God cannot be deceived and God will not deceive. And if God makes a promise, he's able to perform it, or he will never make it. He will never make it. God promises the sinner that will repent of their sins, that wants to be saved, that will repent of their sins, and how to put their trust in the Savior, he promises those people two things that you need to get into heaven. One is the forgiveness of what you've done. That means the dismissal of it all, the removal of it all, the remission of it all, on the one hand, and eternal life on the other. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. What for? That whosoever believeth in him would not perish. That means to die from hell, but have everlasting life. It's trusting in Christ that gets you everlasting life. Acts chapter 10, verse 43 says that to him Christ gave all the prophets witness that through his name, whosoever believeth in him shall receive remission of sins. You get remission of sins in eternal life the same way by trusting in the Savior that God has sent. Saved, sure of it, satisfied. Now the portion that I read very quickly in Mark chapter 8. We have a great multitude with nothing to eat. That's what the world is like today. There's over 6 billion people on earth today. Over 1 billion people in China alone. 1.2 billion people, I think, in China alone. 6 billion people in the world today. And then now was the time in the world when the hearts and lives of people was empty and something they are not there. Now was the time in our land itself when we have so much and yet have so little. People are emptier now than they ever was before. A great multitude of people with nothing to eat. That's the world of which we live. People are looking, they're trying everything going. All sorts of perverted sex. All sorts of things people are trying to get something to fill up that vacuum and that hunger in their life, and they're still not there. It's pathetic to see our young people following these rock singers, movie actors, soap operas, the scum of the earth, the cesspool of sin, and yet they're all caught up with those type of people. People, great multitudes, with nothing to do. Now the question come up, the Lord said, "I'll have compassion on the multitudes. I'll take pity on the multitudes. I have mercy for the multitude. They've been with me these 3 days with nothing to eat." You remember 3 days that the Lord Jesus lay in the tomb. It was 3 days between his death and his resurrection. And the Lord Jesus carried the sins of that multitude that had nothing to eat, that included me and you. He carried those sins to the cross of Calvary, and they lived in the grave for 3 days, and he came out from the grave, victorious over sin and death, and he has something to feed the multitude right now. The gospel, he's the bread of life. He has something to feed you right now. The question says, from whence can a man ever feed such a great multitude with bread here in this empty, barren, dry wilderness? That idea question comes out of the mind of people now. How can the Lord Jesus ever satisfy me? How can he ever satisfy the multitudes of people that are filling themselves with liquor and sex and drugs and pleasures and things, trying to satisfy themselves? But he can. He does. He's the answer to life, and he's the answer to death. So the Lord said to the disciples, he just commanded the people, just sit down. Now when you sit down, you're not doing anything. And one of the greatest problems with people being saved is they're trying to do something to save themselves. They're trying to do something to help themselves. The Bible says we're helpless, we're without strength. Well, we're without strength, and in due time Christ died for us. When you're trying to save yourself, you're not trusting. When you're trusting, you're not trying. They're opposites. So they sat down. They didn't do anything. They just sat down and they ate. And it says they were filled. That means they were satisfied. They were satisfied. A hungry multitude with nothing to eat. A Savior that had compassion on the multitude. And he had the bread that they needed. He had exactly what they needed to satisfy. You're not saved. You're not satisfied. If you're saved and you know it, you're sure of it, then you're satisfied. Let me ask you, you want that hunger filled in your life, that vacuum filled in your life? The nothing this old world has got that satisfies your hunger, it has nothing. You want to be satisfied, you've got to be saved. And that's only by the Lord. It's of the Lord, it's by the Lord. And you've got to be sure of that. And the surety of salvation is in the promises of God. The jailer asked the question, such a simple question. The only place it's asked in the Bible, sirs, what must I do to be saved? It could be simpler, it could be clearer. The answer came just as simple. Believe, trust, rely, depend. Not on yourself, not on your religion, not on anything about you, but trust in the Lord Jesus Christ. And no doubt about it, when you do that, thou shalt be saved. That's a promise. God can't do the trusting for us. And we can't do the saving for God. We do the trusting, he does the saving. What makes me so sure of saving is that he promised that when I trust in him, that shall be the saving. That promise is everybody's promise. Not only the jailer, not only mine, not only Christians, but it's for whosoever will may come and accept that Savior and trust in that promise. And be saved and sure that satisfied. May the Lord help you tonight. If you're not saved, put your trust in the Savior.